Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins. Well, it's been quite a week in politics. Cruz is out and Trump is in. So we'll explain what that means as we gear up for the general election. Hillary Clinton's supporters certainly think that she is a lock to win the presidency this year, but they clearly haven't been paying any attention to what's been happening in the last year. And why are Democrats trying to kill single-payer healthcare in Colorado? We'll follow the money and expose these corporate shills. That's what's coming up tonight. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
So, earlier this week, after the Indiana primaries, Ted Cruz announced that he was no longer going to stay in the race for the Republican nomination. While this is great news for Donald Trump, he no longer has another person that he has to bully on the campaign trail, it really speaks volumes to what has happened to the Republican Party. Because when you look at it on paper, Ted Cruz, as far as being a candidate, not being a human being, but being a candidate, he did everything right and he did everything better than everyone else running for president. Here's what I mean. Last year, around September, October, stories began emerging about Ted Cruz being the sleeper candidate that not enough people were paying attention to. He was setting up a ground game in early states, Iowa, New Hampshire, North Carolina, and all over the South when no other candidates were doing the same thing. Additionally, being a Republican, he also had a few billionaires and many, many millionaires in his pocket to fund his campaign. He was meeting with the right people. He was out there with a solid ground game that was leaps and bounds beyond what any other candidate had put in place. What he didn't count on, and what has fueled Donald Trump's surge, is the fact that the Republican base is even further to the right of Ted Cruz. Now, that's a scary thought. And when we hear people saying that, oh, well, Donald Trump has this net negative favorability, which is absolutely true, it begs the question, then why is he winning? Something isn't adding up. Is it that the polls are just no longer trustworthy? Are people lying to pollsters? Or is this all just made up? Because those two things do not correlate with each other. A net negative approval rating and a campaign that can't stop winning. Those things don't make any sense. And that's what the Democrats are relying on to win in November by saying that Donald Trump is very unpopular and that there's no way he could win. Well, just look at what's happened since February. He has won. He's won in states where he should not have won. He is picking up candidates that he should not be picking up. And a lot of that is fueled by bigotry and hate. We have seen the KKK come out and do recruiting for him. They have come out and openly endorsed him. And that's something that Ted Cruz, in spite of his campaign money, in spite of his ground game, could have never predicted because they don't pay attention. Those of us who've been following politics for more than a decade have seen this slow de-evolution of the GOP base. We saw this coming. We've been talking about it for over a year. But the Republicans like Ted Cruz, they don't learn anything. And that is why Donald Trump is the presumptive Republican nominee. Now on the Democratic side, Bernie Sanders pulled a surprise upset in the Indiana primary on Tuesday after polls showed him down 6 points to Hillary Clinton the day of the election. And he turns around and wins that primary by 5 points. That is an 11 point discrepancy between the polls going into the election and the election results. 11%. And here is the great irony that Hillary Clinton's supporters don't seem to understand. It only took minutes after Ted Cruz dropped out and Donald Trump won Indiana and became the presumptive nominee for Hillary Clinton's supporters and her surrogates and the media personalities that are all in for Hillary Clinton to come out and say, look, we've got the general election on lock. Hillary Clinton is going to defeat Donald Trump. Look at the polls. And most of them pointed to a specific CNN poll that had Hillary Clinton in a general election matchup against Trump at 47% and Donald Trump at 40%. And they said, look, she wins by 7 points off the bat. Well, here's what they didn't take into account. 9% of people in that poll were undecided. So if that 9% goes to Donald Trump, guess what? 49 is greater than 47, idiots. He wins. Not only that, but all the numbers put out by that poll don't even add up to 100%. Where's the remaining 4%? Nothing makes sense. But Hillary Clinton supporters completely ignored the fact that there was an 11-point shift from Tuesday morning until Tuesday evening when those results came in. And suddenly they're relying on a poll showing her up against Donald Trump by 7% when she just lost a state that she should have won by 6%. Pay attention, Democrats, because you're going to lose the general election in November if you keep thinking it's going to be a walk in the park. 2 weeks ago, I had the privilege to sit down with Tom Hartman at a dinner, and we were talking about the fact that the Democrats don't seem to understand. They seem to be taking Trump a little too lightly. They think it's going to be a walk in the park and that he's just too extreme to be elected president. He's a personality, not a politician. And Tom Hartman pointed out something very brilliant that a lot of Democrats have forgotten. And to be honest, it happened before I was even born, so I didn't really know about it. But Tom said, look, in the 1980 election, nobody thought on the Democratic side that Ronald Reagan had a chance. Here we have this washed up actor from Hollywood yesteryear who decides he's going to run for president. No, this is a joke. Nobody took him seriously. He said crazy and outlandish things. So the Democrats thought, well, you know what? We don't have to worry too much. This is our election. Carter's going to get it. 8 years later, when Ronald Reagan left office, the Democratic Party still didn't get it. And we ended up with George H.W. Bush. The only reason Bill Clinton was able to win in 1992 was because Ross Perot siphoned off 20 to 30% of the Republican vote from George H.W. Bush. Had Perot not entered that race, Bill Clinton never would have been president, and we wouldn't be having the Hillary Clinton discussion that we're having today. All because Democrats don't learn. Bill Clinton was helped by a third-party Republican splitting the Republican vote. Hillary Clinton will not have that same advantage. We wrote off a Hollywood has-been crazy loser in 1980, and we're doing the same thing in 2016, folks. We think that Donald Trump is just this crazy candidate that nobody's going to vote for because he's hugely unpopular. Well, if we're going to talk numbers, let's look at Hillary's numbers. She is the second least popular person to ever run for president. The only person more unpopular than her is her Republican opponent, Donald Trump. Voting turnout is going to hit an all-time low this year. And that's going to be helped, in fact, from the assault on voting rights coming from the Republican Party that the Democrats are doing absolutely nothing about. Furthermore, another one of the predictions says that if Hillary Clinton can just win the state of Florida, which should be easy for her, according to these, you know, brilliant liberal analysts, if she can just win the state of Florida and then win the traditionally blue states, she gets the nomination hands down. And they're saying, hey, things are looking pretty good for Hillary Clinton in Florida. Now, let me ask them something. When was the last time you went to Florida? Because I'm here every day. I've lived here my entire life. And just a little bit of anecdotal evidence. Do you know how many Hillary Clinton bumper stickers I have seen in the state of Florida? Literally one. One. There are Trump stickers everywhere you turn. And to be honest, still quite a few Dr. Ben Carson stickers. Several Bernies, a few Cruz. I have seen one Hillary Clinton bumper sticker. And sure, that means nothing as far as the election goes. But let me point this out. If you think that Hillary Clinton is going to easily defeat Donald Trump in the state of Florida, then you haven't been paying attention to the state of Florida. This is a state that not once, but twice elected a man, Governor Rick Scott, to the highest office in the state after his company was found guilty of pulling off the largest Medicaid fraud in the history of the United States. Billions of dollars. Governor Scott, as the president of that corporation, had to plead the Fifth Amendment more than 73 times during depositions in order to not implicate himself in any of those crimes. And we elected him twice. So if you think that a bigot like Donald Trump doesn't stand a chance in the state of Florida, keep in mind that our governor should be in prison for Medicaid fraud. But hey, that doesn't matter, right? You're brilliant paid analysts. You don't have to pay attention to Florida. You don't actually have to go to Florida to understand what happens here, right? You're going to sit back in Washington, D.C. and tell me what's happening in my own state. No offense, but I think I know what's happening in Florida a little bit better than you guys. And Hillary Clinton does not stand a chance here. I don't care what the polls say. I have talked to people. I see what's happening and I see what has happened. Because it's not just the fact that we elect criminals in our state. It's the fact that if there is any sign that Trump is not going to win the state of Florida, his good friend, Governor Rick Scott, is going to purge as many people from the voting rolls down here as he possibly can. Don't think that'll happen? Well, think back to what Jeb Bush did for George W. in the year 2000. And then again in the year 2004. It happens all the time in Florida. And it's going to happen again because we have a criminal Republican governor who is good friends with Donald Trump and who could very well end up on the ticket as a vice presidential nominee. That's terrifying. And furthermore, with this Hillary's walk in the park, what happens to all of those Senate and House Republicans? You know, they may not be a fan of Donald Trump, but they do know they have to pull Republican voters to the polls to get themselves reelected. And while they're there, they're not just going to skip over that part where it says vote for president. They're going to fill in that little line, fill in the bubble, punch the card right next to Donald Trump before going on to vote for Paul Ryan or whoever it may be. They're going to vote Republican. And that is what the party is counting on. They can suffer through 4 or 8 years of Donald Trump as president as long as they maintain control of the House and Senate, because then the corporations know that they're still going to get every single thing they want. And then think of the fact that we have prominent Republicans out there right now saying, you know what? I think I'll probably vote for Hillary over Donald Trump. That's not true. That's not going to happen. These are people who spent the last 25 years of their lives demonizing the entire Clinton family. You think suddenly they're going to vote for Hillary over Donald Trump? No. If you honestly believe that, then you are delusional and probably should find another job and not work in politics. And then here's the thing. If they do decide that they're going to vote for Hillary, shouldn't that scare the Democrats? Why are they comfortable voting for this woman who they've said that they hate? They're not. Corporations are. And that's what's important. This year, if Hillary Clinton is the Democratic nominee, is going to be a hell of a fight. It is not going to be a cakewalk for Hillary Clinton. She is not guaranteed to win. And I guarantee you at some points we're going to see Donald Trump ahead of her in the polls. Because that's what happens every time. There was a time when Mitt Romney pulled ahead of Barack Obama. Same thing with John McCain. Polls change every week. And as we've seen from the primary season, we can't even rely on the polls that are currently out there. So Democratic Party, beware. do not think that this is going to be an easy election. Do not think you can just skate through this and go ahead and coronate Hillary Clinton, because you can't. You have to work. You have to fight back, and you're fighting against a bully who doesn't know any boundaries and who doesn't bother with facts and the truth, and his followers don't seem to care about the facts and the truth. This is a fight like none that we have ever seen. So get ready, because things are about to get very, very ugly. And speaking of things being very, very ugly, according to a new report by Lee Fong writing for The Intercept, a group of Democratic consultants are trying to kill an amendment in Colorado that would provide universal state-sponsored health care to every citizen in the state of Colorado. The group is called Coloradans for Coloradans, and they're trying to fight back against this Amendment 69, which again is a universal health care proposal that's going to be on the ballot this year for Coloradans to vote on, that will provide universal health care for the state of Colorado. The question is, why is this group that is funded by Democratic consultants, many of whom have given to super PACs that support Hillary Clinton, why are Democrats fighting against single-payer health care? Well, the answer is because they're also working for the insurance industry, according to this report. Now, if you don't learn anything from American politics, the one thing you need to take away is that anytime someone fights against universal health care, it's because they're getting money either from the insurance industry or from the pharmaceutical industry, or both in many cases. And that's what we're seeing take place in Colorado. The question is, why has the Democratic Party become so corrupt that we're now fighting against ideas that we were championing just 8 years ago? 8 years ago, universal health care was a tenet of the Democratic Party. It was something that we all agreed that we were going to fight for, and that President Obama, at least on the surface, did fight for as for part of the Affordable Care Act. And now suddenly the Democratic Party thinks that it's a bad idea? And it's not just those Democrats out in Colorado. We've also seen Hillary Clinton say that universal health care is a pipe dream. It's not something we can do. It's not even something that we should, you know, strive towards. This is getting pathetic. The Democratic Party of today is the Republican Party of 8 years ago. The Republican Party has turned into the Nazi Party. But there is, though, more Democratic Party. And the voters understand that. And that's why Bernie Sanders was able to pull off that surprising upset in the state of Indiana, because he's willing to speak out against things like TPP. He's willing to say that college education is a right, and that healthcare is a right, and that paid maternity leave is a right. The Democratic Party has lost its way. And more than likely, they're going to lose this election because they lost their way, and they're going to lose this election to the easiest to beat Republican opponent in modern American history. And moving on. Earlier this week, a jury found that Johnson & Johnson was liable for cancers caused by their talcum powders, and they awarded plaintiffs $55 million in that case. Now, this story is one that most Americans are unaware of. They do not know about the link between Johnson & Johnson's talcum powder and cancers in women. Earlier this week, Mike Papantonio spoke with attorney Kim Adams about the dangers of talcum powder, so let's take a look at that interview.
You know, Kim, after Johnson & Johnson got hit for $72 million on their talc powder case the first time, the spokeswoman for Johnson & Johnson, Carol Goodrich, came out and said that the verdict in that $72 million verdict contradicted years of research that supported the safety of the talc. Well, now they get hit with another $55 million verdict. And it's not looking like Johnson & Johnson's going to really be able to pull through this without admitting that they did something terribly wrong. Tell us about the last verdict. What's the significance about this from a scientific standpoint? I know you deal with both the science and the legal aspects of this. How do you see this verdict?
I see this verdict as a strong message. In both of these verdicts, you're looking at well over $50 million in punitive damages awarded by those juries. Those juries, you know, not just any science gets before the jury. The judge is the gatekeeper, and the judge has reviewed the science, and the juries have spoken. I mean, I think the juries are tired, and the public is tired of being the guinea pig for some of these. And I think Johnson & Johnson and these other manufacturers are going to have to, just like you said, they've got to admit that they should have warned. You know, women in general are also being they're tired of being these guinea pigs, and we're seeing it time and time again that the manufacturers are left to police themselves, and they don't do it. They look at it as the cost of doing business.
Kim, you've been handling these types of cases a long time, just generally product defect cases and pharmaceutical kinds of cases. You're doing interviews on this case with many women that are calling you about this. What are the things that you try to analyze when somebody calls in and then says, look, I have cancer, I believe it's related to my years and years of use of this talcum powder? What are you looking for when somebody calls in? What is important to you?
Look, I'm really glad you brought that up, because the first thing is, these women, whether they want to pursue a lawsuit or not, they need to get with their doctors and get their records. Doctors and hospitals purge records all the time, and we need to make sure we obtain those records. And the client needs to, or the potential client needs to, just for their own well-being. Some of these cancers, the ovarian cancers, they're finding the talc when they do the biopsies. Sometimes biopsies were never done, but we've got to have the medical, you know, records to kind of support what's going on.
Now, you just said something really important, and that is, when they're doing biopsies, these people are presenting with ovarian cancers. And most of the time, most of the time, if it goes untreated, real early catch, it's fatal. And so it's a difficult cancer to treat. And so the question is, we know that they used, that it's not just them telling us that they've used years and years of Johnson baby powder. Right. On pathology, they're actually seeing it in the tissue, the talc in the tissue, that they're putting up on a screen in front, the jury can see it. The scientist or the doctor is saying, well, here's the talc, and here's the cancer right around the talc. I mean, it's pretty clear, isn't it?
It's very clear, you know, that the studies that we've sort of looked at, and I know that are being presented to these juries, show talc being an irritant. It's almost sort of like the asbestos epidemic that we saw in the past. It's kind of the same mechanism, I think. What's really interesting about these talc cases, too, when you look at the numbers, you figure 20,000 plus new ovarian cancer diagnosis every year. Wow. Of those, you've got another 14,000 deaths every year. Now, that has been a little bit on the decline, but when you look at 30 years of talc exposure, when they knew, you know, they're showing documents to these juries that they knew this stuff was causing cancer for at least 30 years, a 30 to 60% increased risk, you're looking at the potential savings. I know that we've sort of analyzed it, and a lot of attorneys have. If you've got 25% of lives caused by these talc exposures, you're looking at a savings of 500,000 women of no diagnosis if they put this warning on 30 years ago when they should have, and another 100,000 plus of lives saved if the manufacturer had just done. They didn't need this product. They had other products they were selling.
Kim, you raised another thing, and I want to talk about the fact they absolutely did not need this product. There's no question. They branded this product. They felt like they had the brand out there, so they had to stay with the brand. They were making so much money on it. At the same time they were making all this money, Kim, though, you point out that the documents show they had every reason to understand that this had the potential to cause cancer, didn't they?
They sure did. In 1999, the American Cancer Institute even said, you know what, we see a link here, and we think you should no longer use talcum-based powders. Maybe you should swap to, you know, one of the other powders that sort of do a lot of the same issues that talc would. But it's not the American Cancer Institute's responsibility. It's the manufacturers to warn these women, and they didn't do it.
Well, here's an interesting thing. We see this, you've seen this so many times in some of the cases you've handled over the years, and I know I see it too. And that is, once a company comes and they spend billions of dollars branding their product, You know, this is Johnson & Johnson's baby powder talc. This is what you need to use. Put it all over your body for a hygiene. If you're adult, put it all over your baby. Everything's fine.
Right.
They brand this like it's great. And so they don't want to do anything to pull it off the market, even though they know that it's causing physical injury.
Right.
They don't want to do anything because they're so committed to that brand.
That's right.
And they've made so many billions of dollars off that brand for decades now. So it's chickens come home to roost for Johnson & Johnson, the way I see it. Kim, do you have another take on it?
No, I definitely think that it has. They've got several more trials set this year. I just really think Johnson & Johnson at some point needs to admit to the public their wrongdoing. You know, and just there's just not enough that can be said about the litigation and the legal field and the communities coming together to put a stop to the manufacturers taking advantage of the public. And I think that they are sending that message loud and clear. One of the clearest we've seen in a long time.
Yeah. Well, you know, the point is this. The point is what we see these companies do many times is they calculate how many people will die using this product. In other words, we can project maybe it's 1,000 women a year will die using this product from cancer directly related to the talc exposure.
Yeah.
So then they calculate how much money are we making on this every year. Then they calculate how much is each one of those lives worth every year. And they conclude, well, if we're making $1 billion, we can afford to pay out $200 million in losses in court. And we see that time and time again. And I almost have to wonder in this case, is that what they've done? One thing for sure, you see a case like this develop. And once you start seeing the beginning of it, it always gets worse. Isn't that your experience?
I absolutely think that is true. Not only for the plaintiffs, but you've got to consider too, you know, I think one of the other things they calculate, not only the cost of that, but how many of these people are going to die off that they're not going to have to deal with? How many of these people are going to have their statutes of limitations to the extent that you've got some, you know, state that's got a, you know, something that they can't get past? So I think that they calculate all of that stuff into their evaluation of, do we try to brand something that's safe? Do we actually update our warning and lose some of these sales? It's really sickening to see the crassness of these manufacturers when they take into consideration taking away the person's life, taking away the person's ability to even have any recourse. And I think the fact that those two aspects are even considered in pushing these products is horrible.
If they've already made $100 billion in all these decades selling it, it's a cost of doing business. They say, well, we can pay out $2 billion and we can kill X number of people and we've still come out ahead on this. And what your position is on this, and from the beginning has been, they need to put a warning on this product. If not, take it off the market,
right,
because of the fact it's not even necessary. They have powders that don't even have this talc that don't kill you by way of ovarian cancer.
Sure.
Kim, as usual, I've watched you handle, you know, big cases. This is certainly a big one, and I appreciate you showing up here, and I hope you'll continue to get this story out there, okay?
Will do. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Kim.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can get more news at our website, theringoffire.com. You can get our daily podcast by going online to rofpodcast.com. You can also subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/goleftv. Follow the show on Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio, and you can follow me at Farron Balanced. And I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you next week.